Chapter 13. I don't want you to worry about this, Mr. Minya told Michael. Yeah, right. Why are they doing this now? Michael said. You know why? Because they don't believe I'm 12, he said. Mr. Minya nodded. It was just the two of them sitting on the bench. The other kids were in a raggedy circle on the infield grass in front of home plate, eating the ice cream sandwiches Mandy's mom had brought as a snack. Does the Grand Concourse coach think I'm not 12? No, he's on our side. He knows this is basically just sour grapes from Westchester South, Mr. Minya said. But he's one of the league's commissioners, and he's got to do his job. So when coaches file a complaint, he has to go by the rules, which we sort of bent when we accepted the baptism certificate. You said coaches, Michael said. I thought it was just the coach of the Westchester South. Mr. Minya put an arm around Michael. He wrote the letter, he said, but quite a few other coaches signed it. They all think I'm lying about my age. No, Mr. Minya said, just a bunch of coaches who think they're good enough to get to Williamsport this year, and that their chances improve tremendously if you're not pitching against them. Now Michael didn't know what to say. It wasn't just Justin's dad. It was a whole gang of dads ganging up on him all of a sudden. Mr. Minya said, This is all not going because you showed up, the man's son. And it was probably going to be a pain in the butt for your father, because somehow he'll have to get help from somebody back in Cuba. He told me he probably could, if he ever really had to, Mr. Minya shrugged. Well, now he really has to. You want to give him his number in Florida? Michael said no. It's okay, I'll tell him. More than anything, Michael wanted to be eating ice cream with everybody else. Be like everybody else. Mr. Gibbs said he's not even worried about it, Mr. Minya said. He joked with me that where he works during the day, he's got a lot more important things to sweat than pain in the butt, little league parents. Michael grabbed his bat and glove. Where does Mr. Gibb work? He said. ACS, Mr. Minya said. Administration for Children's Services. It's a city agency in charge of... Michael cut him off, not even worried that he might have sounded rude doing it. I know what they're in charge of, he said. The next morning at breakfast, Michael said to Carlos, You're telling me there's nobody we can call back home to get me a birth certificate? Papa used to say that if we ever asked somebody back in Havana for a favor like that, they would have thought he was loco, Carlos said. Crazy? But he had my baptism certificate instead, Michael said. You saw it. Carlos nodded. Signed by Father Morales of St. Antonio de Puna. Poppy held on to it like it was a ticket stub to heaven, and when he realized he didn't have the birth certificate, he went and got some kind of paper from Mr. Brown, way back at the start of the school year. Mr. Brown was principal of Michael's school, PS 31, the William Lloyd Garrison School on 156th Street. Carlos said, You think somebody would just stand up and tell this commissioner from the Pinstripers? Mr. Gibbs, Michael said. Tell Mr. Gibbs that they're busting your chops for no good reason. And just make the whole thing go away, Carlos said. I'd tell him myself if he didn't turn out to be from the Administration of Children's Stinking Services. You'll figure something out, Michael said, just like you always do. Carlos reached across the table, put out a closed fist for Michael to touch lightly with his own. My little T-bone, his big brother said, little man. If I was little, Michael said, but just more little than I am, maybe people wouldn't be saying I'm older than I am. That's a lie, Carlos said, and we shouldn't have to prove a lie, Miguel. Carlos, how are we going to come up with a birth certificate if Poppy couldn't? When I figure that out, Carlos said, you'll be the first to know. After Carlos left for work, Michael went downstairs and used the key to Mr. Ruiz's had given him to the storage closet in the basement. He got his pitchback net, brought it outside, and set it up in the alley behind 825 Girard. He set the nut up in the usual place, walked back a little to the mound Mr. Ruiz had built up for him, with help from some friends of his from the Department of Public Works. who had been fixing potholes at 158th Street one day. Before the Matacomb had dried, Michael had run down to Stan's Sports World and bought a pitching rubber that he stuck on the top of it. "Don't tell people I was the one," Mr. Lewis said, giving Michael a wink. "I don't want them to think I'm a nice guy." Michael had told him, "Your secret is safe with me." Then he grinned and added, "Besides, no one would believe me." Now that pitcher's mound was his sanctuary, he threw easily at first, making sure to warm up the way he always did, honoring his instrument, as Poppy had always instructed him. Gradually, though, as he felt the familiar warmth in his arm, the heat, he began to throw hotter and harder, even knowing that he required perfect control on the pitch back, that if he missed his spot and hit the net the wrong way, the ball would go flying over his head and into the street. Before long, it was as if Michael was trying to throw 80 on every single pitch, as if somehow he could strike them all out with his fastballs. Just in the jerk from Westchester South and his father and Mr. Gibbs of the ACS. "It's because they think I'm too good," Michael thought, and fired another one at the net, hitting it dead center. "I'm too good, and they're acting like that's bad."